Thank you very much. And thank you to the organizers for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm happy to share some of the data we've been gathering during the years I've been working on this very interesting topic. So just to briefly show what I'm going to deal with today, something about energy and lysine requirements of reproductive sows, mainly during the transition period and the lactation period. And transition, that is from roughly 1 week before parturition and until day 3, 5, 7, whatever. It's not a very fixed period of time, and then lactation, you know about that. Then I'll kind of introduce what I think is the future, the two-component feeding strategy. I think really that would be the way forward to go if we want to improve dramatically from where we are today. And then I'll talk about what can we do the way we feed them today. How can we improve the farrowing process? Or can we? And how to increase the colostrum production, because the farrowing process and the colostrum production, that's the two most important things for the piglet survival. But let me step back a bit and look at how is it if we feed a growing pig. We have a lot of knowledge from different countries on how to improve the growth rate of growing pigs. That's the feed intake. The more we feed them, the more they will grow. If we know that, the feed intake, we can step to the next level of optimizing growth of growing pigs. That's an optimal ratio between lysine and energy. Not necessarily lysine, but the first limiting amino acid, which is turns out to be lysine, the way we formulate diets. And the third thing is an optimal amino acid profile relative to lysine. So by this scheme here, we have stepping upwards here, we have amino acids that are related to lysine, but lysine is related to energy or the feed intake. So everything is balanced according to energy in this setup. And the thing is here, we also need to have a recommended feeding curve or energy supply, because everything in terms of requirements, that's on a daily basis. But this should be fairly straightforward for nutritionists. And why not just take a copy paste to the sows then? Well, the sow is quite a different species, so to say. If we look at the feed and the milk yield, this is the same as feed intake and growth rate up here. We only see a really, really weak association. And that's quite interesting. How come we only see a weak relation between feed intake and the milk yield? The thing is, the sow is mobilizing. She is investing a lot of her own body to support that milk production. And if we look at feed intake and mobilization, clearly there's a negative relationship. So argumenting backwards in this triangle here, you would say to have a high milk yield, we should have them to mobilize and just skip feeding them. Then they'll produce most milk. Which is, of course, not really true, because we know that 50 to 60% of the nutrients in the feed end up directly into the milk. But how can it be that we see a very, very weak relationship between feed intake and the milk yield? And what is the puzzle between the mobilization, feed, and milk yield? How can we at the same time have a high feed intake, a high mobilization, and a high milk yield? That's the thing that keeps me going to work each and every day, I think. Because this is the key to understand how can we actually improve the sow nutrition. Maybe not so much improving the milk yields, but overall, her lifetime performance. And is it really necessary to have a high mobilization to reach the high milk yield? Or is it simply a consequence of improper feeding? I hope my lecture here or my presentation will tell you that it's probably not necessary to have high mobilization. Let's start another place. We have made some factorial calculations of the energy requirement of sows from 10 days before they enter the give birth to the piglets, so shortly before they enter the farrowing unit here. And then each day throughout transition period and lactation period. And the black, the blue bar here at the bottom, that represents the maintenance. We know fairly well how much energy is required per kilogram of metabolic body weight. On top of that, we can calculate what is required by growth. You can hardly see it, but on the next slide I will justify why I include it also here on the energy slide. The same is true for the fetuses. Very, very, very difficult to see, but it's there. And the same, the energy required for the uterus. It's growing, yeah, but energy-wise, it doesn't require a lot. Colostrum. It starts 5 to 6 days before parturition, and then it increases quite fast. But speaking about colostrum, it's not that high amount, and it's produced over several days. It's actually also produced when the sow is giving birth. So it's not that huge energy requirement on a daily basis. But when we come into lactation, we see quite a huge, actually the most important trait, that is the energy required for milk production. And then on top here, we have something that's red, which we just say heat increment or additional losses. That's due to all the bars that are not blue here. The blue is just heat, but all the other things, reproductive traits, they are being produced by a biological system which are running with an efficiency which is below 100%. And when we have efficiency below 100%, we have additional heat production. A couple of things to say here. The day before parturition, we have a higher value, and that's because they're building nest. That takes some energy. And at the day of parturition, that's the high one here, they are giving birth. We don't know. These 2 days are just guesses from my side. We don't know exactly or have any clue about how high should they be, but we know they are investing some energy in this, and I'll come back more back to this. Okay, what about the requirement of lysine? The same setup, day by day, we can calculate this factorially, and you'll see that the amount of lysine required for the sow body is really, really low. Remember before it was maybe 80% in the late gestation, the amount of energy required by the body, but lysine is really, really low. But now it makes sense why it was necessary to include the mammary growth, because it clearly takes some lysine. Fetal growth takes some lysine, uterine growth as well, colostrum, and milk production is really overwhelming, determining the requirement of lysine for the lactating sow. And again, we have additional lysine because no biological system runs with efficiency of 100%. So we don't really know where that lysine is going. Probably it's the liver that is oxidizing. It's not taken up by the mammary gland. Well, a minor part of it is, but clearly not all these losses here. But it would be really nice to understand where they are going and why we're losing that much lysine. And then maybe I should say that the uterus here is negative. So after parturition, we have a contribution from the uterus. It's quite a big organ, 6 kilograms of wet weight. It regresses during the first week, roughly, of lactation and releases amino acids back to the blood. This is lean, negative lean growth, you could say. It's not a lot of energy, but it certainly is a lot of lysine and other amino acids. So these are the data. Let's take a look at what is the requirement of energy for three different sows, one with low milk yield, the blue one, one with intermediate milk yield, the red one, and one with a high milk yield, the green one here. You can see clearly there's a nice response of how much milk they are producing in terms of how much energy is required by these three different sows. If we look at the lysine, looks quite a lot the same. Different levels, increases from early lactation to peak lactation, and then it levels off and drops a bit. But if we plot these two against, well, plot the ratio, that was what I started with on the first slide. What is pig nutrition about? Energy intake. That was this one. We need to match somewhat the energy intake with what is required, right? The next thing was lysine per energy. So let's stick to that. This is here. This is the optimal, if we should match exactly the sow, what they require on a daily basis of lysine and energy. We should mix a diet which looks like this. Something, this scale here is standardized ileal digestible lysine per megajoule of metabolizable energy. So it increases. The red line here, that shows what is the Danish recommendation of lysine. You can see it fits on a single day the requirement if the sow is high yielding, some days later if it's intermediate yielding, and some days later if it's a low yielding sow. But this is the compromise that we are making if we are feeding sows a one diet strategy, which all do. All our recommendations are based on what is required per feed unit in Denmark, per megajoule, maybe if it's according to the NRC, although they have started now to transfer into a on a daily basis requirement. But this is the consequence of feeding one diet throughout the lactation period. It's okay, it's definitely not perfect. So the optimal lysine to energy ratio, that depends on the day of lactation, it depends on the milk yield, it depends on the sow weight, and we can't really target that with just a single diet. And that leads me to why I believe we can really improve from here where we are today into a new concept of making a two-component feeding strategy. And what is that? Well, I believe a lot we should see the sow as two components. One is the big body. She has a certain need. The other thing is the mammary gland, including the milk production. It has clearly a different need for nutrients and for energy. And we have actually tried that on a small scale, let me admit that. But anyway, we defined a diet, the green diet here in the bottom. This was to cover the energy and nutrients for the sow body. On a daily basis, that sow is almost constant. They lose minor amounts of live weight during this course of lactation, but on a metabolic live weight scale, you can hardly see that. That drop in 10 kilogram is hardly recognizable when you calculate the energy required for the sow body. And then we defined another, and I should say this one is really low in lysine. We wanted to go to 4 gram of digestible lysine per feed unit. We did not succeed to going that much down. We should have been even more down. But I think you can think of this green one as the most poorest gestation diet you can ever come up with. I think that's the one that the sow body needs. And then we have a diet highly concentrated with nutrients for milk production. So low quality feed and really, really high quality feed. That would be the way to go, I think. We've tried that. Let me explain this figure. The blue line here, that represents the Danish recommendation for lactating sows. It has been tested and developed for many, many years. It's based on research. It's based on what is working in practice. We know so far that, well, they should have more feed here in early lactation. But if we give them more feed, they just refuse to eat it. So this is the best feeding practice we can come up with in Denmark if most sows should increase on a daily basis and kind of maximize the feed intake. The red line here, that represents the energy requirement based on our factorial calculations. And that differ quite a lot with the blue line that we are applying in Denmark. So I hope you can see that sows ideally should have maybe up to 2 kilograms more feed per day in early lactation. And at the end of lactation, if we wean them at 28 days, they actually get 2 kilograms too much. So how come we are using this feeding strategy when we can see, hey, it's another one they really require if we should do it better? The thing is, we have to make a compromise. We have to say feeding one diet strategy during lactation, we have to say, how should that be composed? And I think the sows, they don't like to eat it because it doesn't match what they need. We didn't have any problems with the sows. We have tested on the red one. They ate the amount they were allocated, allotted. So I think when we see sows in early lactation that drop in feed intake, think of, hey, probably this feed composition is not really optimal. Okay, we have tested this concept here, the two diets, that's the red one. We gave them more feed at the beginning, and later on they received less compared with the Danish recommended feeding practice. And what did we see in milk yield? We saw that those that were fed the two diets produced better, more milk as lactation progressed. The other dropped, just like we normally see in the other in all the experiments we've been doing. And the red one was really, really good. We actually weaned piglets at 8 kilogram. And we are not giving them access to dry feed on the floor. So this is really, really good. This is a milk production that is really good. What about mobilization? Well, let's just say it's the same. It was not, they did not mobilize more. I wouldn't say they mobilized less. But they clearly improved the milk yield. And that's an indication to me, hey, we can do this better. Over the entire lactation, they did not get more feed. It was just two different components. One was really cheap, the green diet, and the purple diet was clearly more expensive. And I'm sure if I was a farmer to buy these piglets at weaning, I would prefer to buy these and not those that were 7.3 kilogram. We've tried another experiment here. We have tested what happens if we feed sows 70% of their energy and 70% of their lysine requirement compared with 100%. The 100% again was the similar thing as we did before. It was another experiment. But what happened here? Well, 70% of the requirement, they had a feed intake of 145. If we fed them 100% of the requirement, they consumed 186, so 41 kilogram more. Of course, it was highly statistically significant. The SID lysine to ME ratio was the same. Milk yield, the same. Interesting. They can really mobilize a lot and still make the same milk production. Yes, we know that. But is it mobilization that is creating this? Yeah, here it is. But at the other experiment we did, it was clearly the feed that improved the milk yield. So I think by having two different diets, we can actually choose whether we want them to produce more milk, reduce the mobilization, or somewhere in between that. Please may pay attention here that the weight loss of the sow was 37 kilogram on this feeding practice, 70% of their requirement, and only 12 on the 100%. The difference is 25. If we're going to rebuild these body pulls after weaning, I guess we'll have to use 4 times more feed. So that means this one needs 100 kilogram extra. We don't know exactly these costs, how much it costs to rebuild body stores of fat and protein, but my best guess would be 4. And that means here we give this group 41 kilogram more, but if we then give this group down here later on 100 kilogram more, it's a really bad choice. Another thing to mention, did we succeed here? We wanted to feed them 100% according to the lysine and requirement, and still they lost weight. Were we really successful? Well, I think it was really good, because each time we had to predict what are the producing of milk 1 week ahead and feed according to them, to that. When we came 1 week later and measured the milk yield back in time, they have produced more than we expected. So I think it was really promising, this approach. And back to this where we started, is it necessary to have a high mobilization to improve the milk yield? No. I think we start now to understand how we can have sows to produce more milk directly from the feed instead of having sows that goes up and down in body weight, building up in gestation, catabolizing a lot in lactation. That's a really, really expensive way of producing milk for a sow. So this two-component concept, I think it allows us to target individual feeding day by day during lactation, also during gestation. It's just another diet than the purple one. We can target the individuals according to the milk production or litter size. It's easy to count the piglets. We can target it according to the parity. We know there's quite a good relation between sow live weight and parity. Body condition. A lot of farmers are using the back fat scanner, so it would be easy also to target, is it a fat sow, is it a lean sow we have? And we can choose whether we want maximal milk, or we can choose whether we want to minimize mobilization, depending on, for instance, the body condition. Another thing, and I'll come back to that right now, or quite soon, is fiber. They are really, really good around parturition, but fiber are not that good at peak lactation. So this is another concept where we can use it. We can ensure sows are having a lot of fiber around parturition and not overwhelming amount at peak lactation. And we can actually also use such a concept to make the body restoring more efficient after weaning, because we can just choose the green diet and give them more of that. Then they will rebuild the body fat pools. Or we can choose the purple one if we want them to grow more meat. So we can simply say, hey, what is that sow needing? And then plug and play from the silos. But of course it needs an advanced feeding a computer program and equipment to organize everything. But it's available out there. Okay, sow nutrition. And farrowing, can we improve something around farrowing? A couple of years ago, I was asked to contribute to a new book with gestating and lactating sows, and I just took a look at our old colostrum experiments to see what have we seen in terms of number of stillborn piglets and farrowing time. I didn't think I was going at all to work on stillborn piglets, because it takes a lot of sows per treatment to really investigate that. That was at least what we thought at that time. And we figured out that there was a relationship between number of stillborn piglets and the farrowing time. So if sows has no stillborn piglets, it took an average of 5 hours, 300 minutes or 5 hours here. If sows had one or two stillborn piglets, it took 6 hours. And if sows had three or more stillborn piglets, it took 7 hours. So clearly a relationship there, but we couldn't tell from this whether a farrowing time increased the number of stillborn piglets, or whether the piglets were already dead, and that, and because of no physical activity, that it was actually the underlying reason why farrowing time increased. So it could be the hen or the egg problem here. We wanted to understand what was happening. But I've participated quite a lot of colostrum studies, and I started to speculate how come that some sows, when they give birth to the first piglets, is really, really slow, lazy, no intense contractions when they farrow, and others were just pumping out piglets really, really fast. It was not something that during the course of the farrowing, then it suddenly dropped. It was from the beginning. Something was wrong with some of the sows, I believe, and some were just performing like crazy. We started to think of this and came up with the idea that could it be that they are running out of energy? And let's step back now. What happens with energy when a sow eats? This is the last meal before the sow is giving birth. Half of that meal consists of starch. And when all the meal is ingested, it comes into the stomach and the small intestine, and here it stays. it's absorbed. Most of this starch is absorbed during the first 4 hours, 4 to 5 hours. You can see that here. Already after 30 minutes, we see a peak in how much energy is taking up from the GI tract coming from starch. This is glucose coming directly into the blood from digested starch. It peaks after 30 minutes, really, really fast. But note here that after 5 hours, we are as low as before feeding. So when a sow is farrowing, depending on when they start, they may have some starch, glucose coming in, or they may not have anything at all. And then they have quite some hours of farrowing before they are able to raise up and eat. We did some surgery. We want to really understand that. We applied for some money and we got them. And then we did an experiment and figured out that there's clearly a relationship between the plasma glucose during farrowing and the farrowing duration. So if sow has a lot of energy, then they have a high plasma glucose, around 6 millimoles per liter, and then a farrowing takes less than 4 hours. The two worst sows, they have plasma glucose, one below 2 and one between 2 and 3, they took 10 and 12 hours. Really a strong relationship here. Note, this was not many sows. It was only 10. It's a lot of work we're doing with these multi-catheterized sows, but we also had a catheter before and after the uterus. We want really to understand what happens in the uterus when the sow is giving birth. I have a PhD student that will complete his PhD in October this year. You're welcome to contact me if you would like to come and see that. But but this is the first we realized, hey, plasma glucose in that sow is really, really critical. And we couldn't say that they were running out of energy, because it was not a drop we saw. It was totally constant. So maybe it seems like they're running out of energy, maybe during the farrowing, the nest building. We're not really sure about that, but that's how I interpret these data right now. Then we went back to all our old, to our previous colostrum trials and looked into, hey, can we dig some knowledge out of what we have been doing there? We didn't at all pay attention to the farrowing progress in these. We were just taking all the piglets, weighing them, and measuring how much colostrum were they ingesting. But we had all the data that were needed to actually look at these farrowing duration and the energy status. In this case, we just plot them, how many hours is it for each individual sow from the last meal until start of farrowing? And suddenly we realized, whoa, there's really something here we can do better. So seems like sows are running out of energy if they don't not start the farrowing process. If they haven't started the farrowing process after 3 hours. So this was really an eye-opener to us. That's something we can do better. Note, sows with a lot of energy, they completed the farrowing within less than 4 hours. But if they started more than 3 hours after, the farrowing duration just increased hour by hour. And these data here, they are from our experiment at Foulum, where we feed 8 hour intervals. I will bet in practice it's even worse than this, because many feed 2 meals during the working hours. So you can imagine how long a farrowing can be. This is just, farrowing length is just from the first born piglet to the last born. It's not something on average between piglet mean birth interval or anything. It's just from the first to the last born piglet. Then we got the idea, wow, let's take a look at this stillbirth rate. We didn't at all had any expectation that we could see any significant, but we did actually see a significant effect of when we split the data into before sows that started the farrowing before 3 hours. I call these the green sows. They have plentiness of energy. The yellow sows, that's those that are moderately lacking energy. And the red sows, that's those that are severely lacking energy. And there was clearly an effect there. So the more energy they have, the less stillborn piglets they are having. And that's something we can take advantage of. How can we do it? Yeah, of course, we can give them more meals. And then it starts to become a trade-off. The more meals we get, we give them, do we get more do we get a higher mortality of pre-weaning mortality? We don't know that by the moment. But there's certainly one thing we can do without any problems with the pre-weaning mortality. We can give them fiber. Why fiber? Because fiber has a really, really nice effect here. Fiber, when that is consumed, it takes 4 hours until the first fiber reaches the cecum and the colon. It starts to be fermented, but then it will be fermented for at least the next 24 hours. This here just illustrates how flat an energy uptake we have from fiber. This is from feeding until, 6.5 hours, completely flat. But if we give them high fiber, we can simply elevate the amount of energy coming from the hindgut per unit of time. And that's really interesting to do it that way. And I've taken another figure from this study here that shows throughout 24 hours, it's completely flat. We won't see a drop even though the sow is not eating anything during farrowing. They will have a constant level for at least 24 hours, and it depends on the daily amount of fiber they consume. So fiber is really good to ensure a high energy status during farrowing. And we actually did a study a couple of years ago with this. At that time, we recommended to reduce the feed intake 3 days before parturition. Now we recommend to do it 1 day before because we could see they were actually running out of energy. What did we do? Well, we did a kind of this two-component feeding. We used a spot mix feeding system. We could take in two different components. We could take in normal gestation diet or lactation diet. And then we could replace part of the diet with a fiber-rich supplement consisting of sugar beet pulp, soybean hulls, and sunflower meals to partly replace the diet they were supposed to have. So we replaced 350 gram on day 102 to 108 and 700 grams from day 109 to parturition. And our idea was to make sure that they get at least 500 gram, not exactly, but at least 500 grams per day. What did we see? We saw that the stillborn mortality dropped from 8.7 to 6.6, 3-star significant, and we reduced the total mortality from 22.3 to 19.9, 2-star significant. So clearly a great effect of the fiber, and I think the explanation is what I showed you just before. They have actually more energy when they are farrowing. We were doing this experiment because we wanted to improve the colostrum yield. Did we succeed? Well, not really. I wouldn't also not say that we failed. It went slightly down, but not statistically. Another thing that was positive was the percentage of sows that were medicated. It was actually also reduced. So there are nothing here in this experiment that says, hey, yeah, it's good for this, but it's bad for something else. Everything is positive here. Fiber around parturition seems to be really, really consistently good. And there's another reason why fibers are probably really, really good at parturition. That's because of constipation. This is from a Finnish scale, demonstrating how feces can be scored. Maybe I should say we would like a score of 3. And if it's not 3, 4 is better than 2. 2 is constipation. 1 is really severe constipation. And the problem is constipated sows has problems giving birth to piglets when the piglet has to proceed through the birth canal. The feces, if it's like this, very dry feces, it can act as a physical barrier. Those of you that has been giving birth assistance to sows will remember some of them. Yeah, you can actually feel that hard feces when you're doing it. So, and the Finnish researchers here, they have figured out that there's a relationship between farrowing length and whether the feces is soft or really dry. So we definitely don't want to have constipation of sows, and the fiber helps for that. And if you think of a woman going to the hospital to give birth, the first thing she will experience is that the doctors come with some, in Denmark we call it lavement, and that helps to really empty the hind gut, so the feces come out. So it's not something unknown, but it's just something we should look at. And it's really good just to look at the feces in the at the end of gestation, because if you reduce the feed intake too much, that will by itself stimulate constipation. So something to look at. Another thing of nutrition is is and farrowing length, that is the body condition. This is also the Finnish researchers that found that sows that are, I would call them obese, they have more problems giving birth than sows that are more lean. So now we would say, well, maybe it's better to go even more down. No, they also have the problem that we don't want them to have shoulder lesions. We also want them to have to produce as much milk and colostrum, and etc. So in Denmark, we recommend between 16 and 19 millimeter of back fat for various reasons. This is one of them. Sow nutrition and colostrum production. How can we improve colostrum production? Or is it necessary? Well, Christian told you before about the hyperprolific Danish Danbred sow, and it is really successful how they have increased the litter size. But when the litter size is increasing, the colostrum and milk yield clearly increases on the sow level, but for the piglets, they experience a drop. So per piglet, they will have less. And that means we have to really optimize what we can in terms of nutrition, because as much as we can do to increase the colostrum yield of the sow and the milk yield of the sow, the better it is for the piglets. Also, because if we don't feed them properly, they will probably not come back into estrus after weaning, or maybe it will be delayed 3 or 6 weeks. And it may also have, if we don't feed them properly, it may have some severe consequences of sow longevity. Speaking about colostrum, I wish I could say it's the colostrum yield that's the most important. It's not. It's clearly the colostrum intake. Each and single piglet need to ingest enough piglet, enough colostrum to stay alive. Second most important factor, that is the colostrum yield, because that increases the probability that all the littermates ingest enough. And the third thing is the colostrum quality. So composition, for instance, fat content of the colostrum, contents of immunoglobulins and growth factors. Unfortunately, this here represents also kind of where most researchers has investigated their time during the past, and that's not here, but here. Most has been done down here. It's quite easy to take a colostrum sample and analyze it. It's really hard work to work with measuring the colostrum. But we have done that, and Elaine Canel from INRA in France has done that. She showed some really nice figure that the mortality of piglets is really high if piglets only consume very small amounts of colostrum. And if they increase from below 100 to below 200, the mortality drops from more than 60 to slightly more than 30, and then it further drops the more colostrum the piglet is ingesting. So clearly, this is highly, highly important. I see it as the need to stay alive in terms of the energy requirement. If they don't get enough colostrum, they are not having enough energy to survive until the sow milk production increases, starts around 30 hours after parturition. There's also an aspect of immunoglobulins here, but they only need very, very tiny amounts. All those piglets from here and that way, they have plentiness of immunoglobulins. So it's the energy they are running out of. We've tried to look at just 60 farrowings in our colostrum experiments, just plotted one sow here, and then the 60 sows are vertical lines. One blue dot here represents one piglet. So the one up here, that's the piglet from first sow that ingested most colostrum, and the one that ingested less colostrum in that litter it's down here. And the red one represents the mean uptake of that litter, actually representing the sow production. So I hope to convince you that there's really a lot of variation between littermates and really a lot of variation between sows as well. If we just place a line here, that's coming from Elaine Canel work, stating that 250 grams of colostrum is needed, then we can see that 90% of these piglets are below, and they are actually in a quite high risk of dying. You remember the other figure, that those that are laying down here, they die with a risk of 33%, and those below here, they are dying with a risk of 63%, roughly. So these are really susceptible and in a increased risk of dying. I think it's important to understand why are some sows not able to even produce enough colostrum for the mean piglet? Because they are contributing a lot to the piglet mortality if the farmers
are not fast removing them to other piglets. And the problem is here, you can't really see it on the piglet. It's not a green light or a red light showing, hey, we have three piglets here, come and get them. Very, very fast, they become skinny. It takes a few hours. They can go from looking okay to look really, really bad. So it's a matter of time, but it's also a matter of, can we learn something from this to be able to spot which sows, which litters are problematic? And yes, there's clearly a pattern. There are three risk factors as we see it. The red one, that's those where sows has low feed intake before the farrow. So if you spot sows that are not eating the whole ration, they should be supposed to. Most sows are just eating everything before parturition. If you see sows that are not eating well during late gestation, that's a litter I would pay attention to when once it's born. They typically also give birth one day before the other. So if you know most sows are giving birth on a Wednesday, if you see litters being born on a Monday or Tuesday, take a look at them. Pay a bit more attention to these. The other risk factor that is large litter size, that's the green one. Of course, the sow has a capacity to produce colostrum, and if that has to be distributed across too many individuals per piglet, that's not enough. And the third thing is low mean birth weight for the litter. So if all the piglets are really small, they can be the limiting factor for how much colostrum they can remove from the sow. And these three things, as soon as the sow has ended farrowing, these three things are known, and we can say, hey, maybe we can put a mark telling this sow or this litter needs to be paid more attention to than most others. Okay. In a moment, I'll come back to how can we improve the colostrum production of sows. But we know that we can increase the colostrum yield by 20%. And by doing that, we can move all these dots here 20% upwards. I believe if we can ask the sow to produce 20% more, each and every individual will have a higher intake of 20%. Because they are filling the stomach, and then they're going and sleep. And then when they wake up, they go and fill the stomach again and sleep. It's not like one big litter mate takes everything. They can't do that. So once an hour, roughly, maybe once per 45 minutes, they can fill the stomach and then they're sleeping again. So what happens if we increase the sow colostrum yield by 20%? We actually reduce the number of piglets from 19 to 12%. Below the critical line here. It doesn't mean all 12% are dying, but this is the way to go, I think, in Europe. If it was in Brazil, we would just say, hey, you guys, you have to stay with these pigs and these sows. Watch them carefully. But that's not how we're working in Europe. The salary is too high. We need to have the sow to work for us. And this is the way I think we should have it. We should feed sows better to improve the sow colostrum yield, and that will ensure that the piglets ingest enough colostrum. This figure here is just to explain why am I focusing not in this coming slides not on colostrum intake but on weight gain during the colostrum period. The reason is the black bar here that represents a model I've been developing to measure colostrum intake. And that one is more precise than the one they are using in France. So it's really hard to compare the data from Elin Kennel Lab with the data I've been publishing, because it's two different ways of calculating it. The data we are using fits really, really well with how much we can measure they have consumed using isotopes. And so just to not confuse with these two different methods, I've chosen to present data as how much are the piglet gaining in weight during the colostrum period, because that's universal. It's very easy to record, and it's actually a good relationship between the colostrum weight, the weight gain in the colostrum period, and the actual colostrum consumption. And I would say we can, for across all the data we have in the literature, we can make a mean, which is 95 gram. That's what an average piglet is gaining in weight during the first 24 hours. And the range on a group of sows that are fed the same diet is, in for normal sows, it's within 3 standard errors of this mean, which is from 80 to 110. So if we say below 80 gram per piglet, it's bad. If it's above 110 gram per piglet, it looks really good. And now with these data in mind, I will present what we have figured out in different experiments. The first experiment we did was high amounts of sugar beet pulp or fiber from pectin residue. They performed really, really well. But in the same experiment, we used high levels of potato pulp, and they produced really bad. We can't tell any difference really from between the sugar beet pulp and the potato pulp in terms of solubility of fiber, fermentability of fiber. Of course, it's a different fiber source. But except that, it's really hard to understand why that one is so bad and sugar beet pulp is so good. But that's consistently what we see. There are some fiber effects. We cannot explain them in terms of fermentability, solubility, whatever. There are some intrinsic things, I think, from the fibers that we still don't know, but that's just the way it is. All the data we see on common gestation diets or lactation diets are giving values within the normal range between 80 and 110 grams of weight gain. Then we try to look at sugar beet pulp, not that high as we used here, alfalfa, and again a standard diet from the last 10 days before parturition. The first one was throughout most of the gestation period. That's really a long period if we want to feed fiber. And we knew that colostrum is produced close to parturition, but we didn't really know when. So we fed them the last 10 days before parturition, and we didn't see anything significantly or anything that really said to us, something wrong. Something is good or something is bad. Should I say something? Consistently, it seems like sugar beet pulp is pulling upwards, but here it's not any response really. These data down here is from INRA, from Elin Canell lab, and they tested sugar beet pulp, sunflower cake, and soybean hulls during the last 9 days of parturition, and compared with a low fiber. No statistical response, slightly below what I would call the normal range, but they saw that small piglets benefited if the sows had more fibers. We have tried to see if we can find that in our data, and we can't, unfortunately. It would have been really nice if we can feed the sow somehow, that she can take better care of all the small ones, because they are the most susceptible individuals. But we can't see that, unfortunately. So I would say fiber source is important. Fiber content, sorry, I can't give you anything here. We haven't done any dose response trial on fibers. I hope we soon are able to present some data, but at the moment, no. And when should we use the fibers? I've been thinking a lot about this. The first experiment we did was throughout the gestation period. Then we moved to the last week of gestation, 10 days of gestation, 14 days of gestation, and haven't really seen any big effect there. Maybe it's 1 month we have to go back. We don't know it, but I think it's not only the last 5 to 6 days where we can see the mammary gland is growing really rapidly and a lot of genes are expressed differentially. So we can't be that sure, but certainly we should do anything we can for the sow to produce as much colostrum, because it has a huge impact on the piglet's performance after birth, after weaning, even until slaughter. Okay, what about fat? We have tried sunflower oil. That's the last week of gestation. That seemed quite well. Coconut oil and octanoic acid also quite well. Octanoic acid is not something we can use just because it's not a accepted fat source, at least in Denmark. Fish oil is bad, and well, not really bad, but compared to the other fibers, fat sources, it's clearly not really good. Again, the lactation standard diet within the normal range. Then we tried less fat. This was 8% added fat. Then we tried less and didn't see any great responses there. So probably there is something relationship between the amount of fat and our colostrum production. We have tried a study with 1.3% CLA, so conjugated linoleic acid. That was really bad. So, and when we told the farmer, hey, this is really bad, he skipped using it, and afterwards his production actually improved quite a lot. So something is working, even in practice when we're doing these kind of things. So just to conclude on the fat, yeah, fat source is important. Fat content, we can't really say whether we should use 3 or 5%. We know 8 is not doable in terms of pellet quality and how long time the feed can be stored before used for the animals. The time, I'm quite sure here that it's okay just to use 1 week. It seems like we are having great responses in just 1 week. So that's in contrast to the fiber you saw before. So that's at least something we can, hey, say this is more doable in just mixing it into the lactation diet. Yeah, so just to conclude on this talk, lysine, back to the requirement stuff. Lysine is dictated solely by, almost solely by the milk yield. We see huge differences between between individuals in terms of how much milk they're producing and therefore also how much lysine and other amino acids they require. Energy, that's required both by the sow body and the milk production. I think the two-component feeding strategy is the way forward. At the moment, it's more a research tool, but I think this is really what we can progress from where we are today. Farrowing process, sows are running out of energy. So we have to develop new strategies to improve that before parturition, so they are not giving birth to as many stillborn piglets as they do today. We can use more meals, we can use fiber in the diets, and fibers are good because it reduces constipation and it's prolonged the energy uptake from the GI tract. Seems like the effect of fiber on the farrowing process, that's related to how fermentable the fibers they are. We recommend in Denmark not to go below 500 grams of fiber on a daily basis. And we should also pay attention to that obese sows, they have extended farrowing length. And for the colostrum yield, piglet survival, colostrum is probably the most important factor for piglet's survival. If they are not getting anything, they will die for sure. We see a huge variation among piglets and a huge variation among sow production. We've seen that fibers are really good. And here, we don't see any relationship between fiber, between fermentability and colostrum yield of the sows. So that's in contrast to the farrowing process. I guess all fibers are good for the farrowing process, but it seems like not all fibers are good for the colostrum yield. That's how I interpret our data. And fat source is important as well. sunflower oil, coconut oil seems to be really good, but do not recommend CLA. Yeah, and with that, I think we know a bit more each day and year of the puzzle of understanding the sow, but we really need to understand what happens inside the sow, because that's where the secret is. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Peter. You have talked and talked and talked. Very interesting topics, but I think you will take a few questions.
Sure, sure.
So, the question with the most likes is, will the effect of fiber be the same when enzymes are incorporated in the feed? Do you have any experience in that?
We have actually recently we tested an experiment with enzymes that was during the lactation. And we saw improved digestibility of nutrients and a clearly reduced mobilization. No impact on the milk production, but I think using enzymes, it's not problematic from my point of view. It ensures more energy is digested, more other nutrients are digested as well. And I think, yeah. If all fibers were cut into really, really small molecules or even monomers, it would be a problem. But that's not how the enzymes are working. So it only cuts it partly, and I think they're even better to use than no enzymes. And as far as I was told, they're not that expensive. So I think it's another way to go too. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Did you measure the long-term effect of the two-phase strategy on subsequent oestrus? And
No. Okay. And we had quite few animals. It's really tough. The way we did it, we have to weigh the piglets every week. We have to type in the data really fast, go and calculate how much milk are they producing, calculate how much feed should they be supplied. So we had 5 hours from ending the weighings until we had to type everything. I was really, that was not the way it should be done. It should be done based on number of piglets and so on. But no, when our experiments stop, we're not having money to follow up, unfortunately. That's something to do in practice.
Yes. I think we'll take the last question. Do you consider some specific components of the fiber are more important than others in order to improve the farrowing process? So the different,
No, I think for the farrowing process, it's more the fermentability. It's that provides energy. The more fermentable, the more energy. And the less fermentable, it's just passing through. If we speak about colostrum, it's another story, because then I think we are back to that all the metabolites that are coming to the blood, some of them has bioactive effects. We don't know how it works, but I think that's the secret behind why some fiber sources are better than others.